Oh, wait a minute. Do it again. Sorry. One more time.
Ooh, everybody likes this. Ow. Yeah.
There we go.
Totally.
Shall we do this thing?
Great way to start.
Isn't it good? I'm so thrilled to have you here, seriously. And we're, of course, sitting in front of your beautiful set here at ACT, so which is why you're here in Seattle right now. You are performing your latest solo one-woman show. Lauren Weedman does not live here anymore. Doesn't live here anymore. But I first want to kind of give our audience, our viewers, our listeners, a sense of your, a bigger sense of your career, because you've pretty much, I think you've succeeded in most every medium. Do you feel that way?
No, I don't at all.
I think you have.
But
for
I, okay, then yes,
TV,
I have.
TV, film, memoir, nailed it.
Yes.
Of course, theater. Mm-hmm. And so let's talk about TV.
Okay.
First, you are a regular on Almost Live.
That's right,
King
Almost
TV
Live.
Here in Seattle, a sketch comedy show. We've worked on that together.
Yes.
And I think some of your really big credits, I'm cherry picking from your long list of IMDb, Hung,
yes.
Which was HBO series. Your character was
Horny Patty.
What did she do?
She was a chronic masturbator. that's what
was it written
say,
that
right?
way?
Yeah, no, I brought that in. They wanted her to be just somebody who liked to garden, and I was like, what if she's a gardener who's a chronic masturbator? And they said, we love you on PBS.
And
no,
it
was an HBO
off.
Thing, so it was like she was supposed to be not a chronic masturbator. Sorry to start off like that.
No, it's fine. It is what it is.
It's the biz.
It's the biz. Yeah.
Blame the biz.
Was that fun to do?
It was fun to do because it was a character that was so, she was so kind of broken and odd and hiring this this male prostitute. And the best part of it was afterwards to be walking down the street with my child and have people like, Horny Patty. Horny Patty, I love your work. I love what you do with the Horny Patty stuff. Really good. My sister loves you on Horny Patty. And I was like, I'm sure your sister does.
No, I bet she does.
Yeah, that was, and I had to do like sex scenes, which was really bizarre.
Was it hard?
It is because the days of the shoot, I only did two. And like the day of the, when they're escorting you to the set, it's like dead man walking where like nobody looks at you.
Because you're going to be naked.
Well, they do. They put a sticker. They're just like, here's the sticker.
Oh, they sticker on the things that we got to not see.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess, I don't know. It's all very like, and it's a bit of a blur because I was sort of like, adrenaline rushed out of it. And I was pregnant the first time, and then I just had a baby the second time. Mm-hmm. And the second time was just
You've only had one baby, by the
way.
Right, you were pregnant the first time,
yes, just
and
one,
then
just
one. You said one
yeah,
baby.
Yeah, exactly.
So
anyway, but no one wants to look at you because they're all like,
they want to be respectful. Like, it's no big deal. It's not a big deal. We're just
right. Or they're thinking that I'm supposed to be going into. They're also like, you can have whatever kind of support team you want around you, that day. And I was like, support team? Like, what do you mean? Like, your people? Like, well, we have actresses who bring in their managers and their sponsors for the program, and anybody who can be there for them. Your best friends who are going to be there. And I'm like, I don't want anybody around when I want to be alone so I can really enjoy.
And just be in the moment.
Yes, with
the actor. Looking was another one.
That was the best.
HBO series. That part, so what was your character in that? And I think that they expanded that role because you were so good.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, because I became beloved. And I made that a goal. I said, Lauren, become beloved.
You were the best friend?
I was the best friend of one of the boys, like a group of gay men in San Francisco. And it was about their friendships and looking for love. And I was the best friend of one of the main guys. And then I was a reoccurring part for the first season. And they actually said, they're like, if you can make yourself beloved, my manager.
They
like,
usually said that.
They said that. And I was like, that is the most, like, what are you talking? How do you, like, you know, here are, like, I brought everybody. Here's some lavender oil for everybody. What do you like? She was like, you got to become like Margaret Cho. You got to become such
funny.
I'm like, how? That can't be an intention.
No. It just is going to happen.
Because it make you irritate. Yeah. It's like, I feel like I'm going to get the opposite.
Anti-beloved.
Right. So that's what I thought. I thought, you know what? I don't need them. And then,
I'll show them.
Yeah, and then they loved me. But it was just a great fit of a show for me because of being around a group of very sweet, very gracious. Gracious isn't the right word. They just were. Everybody was really into the jobs that mattered to everybody.
Right.
Because it was the one job I've done in Hollywood. That mattered, had meaning. And to others, like people, it mattered. Like it did. It still mattered to boys in Iowa to watch gay programming, to watch gay stories that were sort of smaller in scope, that weren't just about like all about coming out or about.
Right.
You know, they're just about relationships.
About life. about life being a gay person, whatever that might mean.
Yes, right, yes, right. Yeah. Well, you know, well, doing stuff that gay people and Satan like to work out together. So that's their business. See you in hell. It was an amazing show, and it was almost awful to have something you love. Don't love anything.
Okay,
that's the message I can say to the children. Don't love. Yeah, you know, if you love it, just throw it into the river and be like, it'll be there forever, like Harold and Maude. Just keep that, like, you throw the thing you love away and just like, there it is, because I can't handle it, because I'm going to lose it eventually.
So anyway, Merry
Christmas.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Okay, so that was looking. Then The Daily Show with Jon Stewart.
Yeah.
You were a reporter on that
what?
Show. You were a reporter? A reporter?
I thought you said you made a quarter. And I'm
made
like,
a
quarter. I don't save money. It's true.
You're poor, right?
Yeah.
How was that? You got some really interesting experiences.
I did because I wasn't used to being in that world. Mm-hmm. Now I understand it, but at the time,
that was your first big, huge break.
Absolutely. Right? It was the show that, well, Almost Live helped it because mm-hmm. I'd done some, you know, I did the TV in Seattle. So then when I got to New York, I had some tape.
Right.
For, you know,
right.
they could look at
right.
and see I had some experience. And then when I got that job, and I was up all, like, when I got the news, I got it, I walked around the city all night long because I was so buzzed from the news. And I was like, it's happened. Like, this is it.
I've been launched.
Yes. And I'm like, it's going to, and I didn't really know the show that well. Uh-huh. I just knew that it had a lot of street cred mm-hmm. and it was a smart show, mm-hmm. you know, that people respected mm-hmm. it. And I'm like, well, thank God, Megan's going to be on, I'm going to be on a smart show. Mm-hmm. And then when I got on the show, it was just so stressful because I didn't know how to handle, like, if I saw Jon Stewart in the hallway, I didn't understand that he had a lot to do.
Right.
So I didn't, you know, I would
Did you try to be friends?
Yes, like constantly, where I was just like, how was your weekend, Jon? Well, mine was weird. I go, I feel like my marriage is falling apart, Jon. I don't know. It's like, he's there for me, then he's not. You know what I mean? And he was just like, good to see you, Lauren. Like, we'll see you at the pitch meeting. And I was like, speaking of pitch meetings, how am I doing? How do you think? Like, I was just so...
You needed something.
I did, and I didn't... I was used to theater where we all circle up and give each other massages.
So, but that was one of you... That was a big break.
It was. I didn't handle it well, but I got fired, basically. Or not... Contract not renewed.
Oh, I had that happen in L.A.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it happens a lot.
Oh, it happens all the time.
Yeah,
oh, you're 13 weeks, you're not picked up.
Yes, yeah. Or I was put on freelance, and mm-hmm. I was like, cool, I think freelance is better. And I walked out of the office after accepting my freelance contract, and I ran into one of the producers, and she was like, so, like, what's happening with your contract? Are you coming back? And I go, I got freelance, which I think is better. And she goes, freelance is fired.
Bye-bye.